Welcome back to the class. We are in the last session of this week, and we have been discussing the questions related with Dalit women, and it's a part of a larger debate within Dalit studies. And in the previous class, we had a brief look at a very brief essay written by Gopal Guru titled "Dalit Women Talk Differently," which talked about the political relevance as well as epistemological significance of Dalit women's unique voice. And continuing that particular debate, we already started discussion on this essay written by Sharmila Rege titled "Dalit Women Talk Differently: A Critique of Difference and Towards a Dalit Feminist Standpoint Position." So we started off this essay in the last class, looking into the kind of an introductory points that she made. So we are continuing with this particular essay. Dalit theorization from difference to more difference. Feminism of the 1970s had developed indifference from the left. Crucial to this difference were three categories, that is, women, experience, and personal politics, which were central to feminist theorization. So these three categories were powerful as political rhetoric. They posed theoretical problems. The category of women was conceived as collectively based on their being oppressed by the fact of their womanhood. The three categories were deployed in combination, and this often led to exclusion around race, class, ethnicity. Since most of the vocal feminists in the 1970s were white, middle class, and university educated, it was their experience which came to be universalized as women experience. So this is a important section because she is kind of summarizing the ideological critique of Dalit women or even black women against the liberal feminism that was mostly influenced by the left ideology, and it revolved around three points. One is about the category of women, second one is that of experience, and then personal politics, because almost every woman who articulated women's questions were white, liberal, upper class, university educated women who tend to monopolize the experience of other women as well. So thus sweeping arguments such as "all women are niggers" are made. Yeah. So how these experiences were kind of monopolized. The ambivalence of left towards the notion of women's issues was thus countered by an assertion that women are essentially connected with other women, and subjective experience of knowledge becomes the basis of the universal experience of womanhood. Thus, experience became the basis for personal politics as well as the only reliable mythological tool for defining oppression. Okay, so the critic argued that the way in which one understands one's own experience is by through their own their own lived experience, and this lived experience offer you the kind of a political perspective and political vantage point to enter into the larger kind of political arguments. At least three major postulates emerge from such an epistemological position. One, that there is a system of male domination, that this system is political, and the politics included all power relations, regardless of whether or not the power operated in the public sphere. That is to say, the personal was declared to be political, and as focus came to be on the power in intimate relationship, critique of state or capitalism took a backseat. So this is again, we mentioned as earlier, that in the second wave of feminism, power was brought into the fore, and the feminism was seen as an ideological platform to fight against every forms of power oppression. So this power oppression is not only seen as being from the state or from the market, but also it is seen as having pervaded even in the private sphere. So the personal is political. That argument reflects this particular position, that a feminist by definition has to be sensitive to the power relations even within the household, within the private sphere. So you can't be a very submissive wife and submissive daughter and then practice feminism outside, because then you would be oblivious to the kind of a power relations that dominate you within the domestic sphere. Yeah. Several factors have played a constitutive role in the process that brought the category of difference to the center of feminist analysis. This has meant as a focus of language, culture and discourse to the exclusion of political economy, a rejection of universalism in favor of difference, an insistence on fluid and fragmented human subject rather than collectivities, a celebration of marginal and denial of all causal analysis. So now coming back to this question of differences, because as we mentioned earlier, the preoccupation with difference can be endless. Okay, preoccupation with difference can be endless. The moment you say that your experience is unique and your experience provides you with a unique perspective, then people's experience differs significantly on the basis of your socioeconomic and other kind of positionalities. So this excessive preoccupation with the your standpoint, with your social location, can be so fragmentary. And it is so fragmentary that it can really jeopardize the possibilities of forging a larger alliance and then presenting a kind of unified front. So this means a focus of on language, culture and discourse to the exclusion of political economy. So larger critic or against political economy, larger critic against a capitalist system, larger critic against the state can take a backseat, and you can keep on focusing on the on culture, language, ethnicity and other things that keep people divided. A rejection of universalism in favor of difference, okay? An insistence on fluid and fragmented human subject rather than collectivities, because this one of the most important tendencies of postmodernist theory is that it denies criticizes the idea of a kind of a more unified human collective identities. It always talks about fluid identities, it talks about fragmented identities, so it talks about fragmented subjectivities. So all these preoccupation with fragments and then fluidity and then fragments can actually prevent you from forging a more clearer set of demands, clearer set of agenda and all such kind of certainties. So, a celebration of marginal and denial of all causal analysis. This shift in perspective has been aided in the different ways by the following key factors. So, what are the reasons that actually contributed to that? The collapse of actually existing socialism and the loss of prestige that this brought about for Marxism in the Anglo-American academics. The enormous and continued political interrogations of white middle-class feminism by black and third world feminists. So she is giving a kind of a historical context of this emergence of this debates in the Western world. So I'm not going into the details. So she talks about the significance of psychoanalytical analysis led to the sexual differences even among different people. So the rise of post-structuralism and postmodernism and the increasing alliance of feminism with the same. This has also meant broadly taking one of the following two positions. Position of cultural feminism, which sees feminists as having the exclusive right to describe and evaluate women. Therefore, passivity comes to mean peaceful sentimentality, means nurture, etc. To say that very defining of women is not challenged, only the dominant male definitions of the same come to be challenged. The second point that she talks about is the position of nominalism, okay, the preoccupation with the nominalism. It is argued that a category called women cannot exist. It is fictitious because there are several differences, race, class, etc., that construct women differently. So the second aspect that defined this post-structuralist and postmodernist position is a preoccupation with the kind of a nominalism, preoccupation with the kind of a cultural facts that define you, who you are. So thus, using the category of difference, feminists came to celebrate the aspects of femininity that were previously looked down upon, or the different voice of women of different nationalities, race, classes, etc., came to be celebrated. So there was a celebration of this multiple and then fragmented identities. That is, their plurality is underlined without an analysis of the structures of racism, patriarchies, international division of labor and capitalism. Therefore, all analysis came to focus on identity, subjectivities and representation. So this is the crux of the argument that scholars like Rege puts forward, that the focus shifted from the kind of factors, the kind of a larger structural factors that make that makes these differences uniquely oppressive. And the focus shifted into the kind of fragmented identities which are marked by class and caste and other kind of and ethnicity and then racial differences. The plurality is underlined without an analysis of the structures of racism, patriarchies, and international division of labor and capitalism. Therefore, all analysis came to focus on identity, subjectivities, and representations. Now, at this point, it is important to take note of the fact that there has been a resurgence of identities and importance of naming the differences that emerges out of race, sex, and so on cannot be denied. But it is important to underline the fact that we don't have to accept the postmodernist notion of plurality or difference in order to take note of these differences. Okay, so Rege has a very critical position against this postmodernist celebration of differences. That is to say that no doubt the notion of differences did play a significant role in black and third world feminism, third world women naming their oppressions, but as an analytical and political tool, its value is limited. Okay, so that is the most important argument. The celebration of identities are fine, but what do you do with these identities? Okay, what is the ultimate purpose of these identities is a very important question. A shift of focus from naming differences or different voices to social relations that convert differences into oppressions is imperative for feminist politics. So this is again a fundamental point. So if you go to the previous argument, that she is arguing that the relations of patriarchy and racism and international division of labor are the larger forces that, you know, make these differences into oppressive mechanisms. So without addressing that, without addressing these larger structural factors, this celebration of differences will not yield any political positions. It will not give any political dividends. A shift of focus from naming differences or different voices to social relations that convert differences into oppression is imperative for feminist politics. Yeah, so she talks about, you know, P.H. Collins, an important black feminist, and then talks about how, she seems to have changed her kind of position. Now, we shall argue that we need, instead, is a shift from focus from difference and multiple voices to the social relations which convert differences into oppressions. Okay, so what? How do we explain that women who belong to a different caste position, okay, are experience the oppression in different ways, or why that the women who are born in a lower caste family have to experience more stringent forms of domination? And so this has to be the focus, rather than saying that the experiences of Dalit women is different and white women and upper caste women is different. So instead of merely celebrating the differences, the focus should be on much larger and structural factors that, you know, use these differences and then perpetuate the differences to different sections of social identities. So that is her argument, argument that she puts forward. Now, this is the section historicizing differences, women in non-Brahmin movement, which she gives a lot of examples from women's movement, especially from Maharashtra, in which Dalit women are seen as, you know, putting forward a more broader politics, and not merely celebrating their differences or not merely emphasizing their nominal identities and their unique experiences. So I am not going into the details, because it's a more of a kind of a historical analysis, but let's see. The radical historiographies of colonial India, though they emphasized the autonomous role of peasant, labor, and other subaltern groups, equated the historiography of colonial India with that of the Indian nationalism. And the non-Brahminical reconstruction of historiography of modern India in the works of Omwith, Patil, and Aloysius have underlined the histories of anti-hierarchical, pro-democratizing collective aspirations of the lower caste masses, which are not easily encapsulated within the histories of anti-colonial nationalism. So she is commenting on how Indian nationalism was understood. The criticism is that the Indian nationalist movement always had a kind of a nationalist character, and that most of the time it privileged the upper class experiences and upper caste women. And how there are, you know, alternative studies or alternative arguments against that by Aloysius and Sumit Sarkar and Gail Omwith and others. So these are kind of more debates about how this you know, movements during, say, Jyotirao Phule's movement in Maharashtra and other things kind of shaped during the colonial period. So let us skip that. It's a kind of a more historical analysis, but she is making the argument that many of these movements had the real larger revolutionary potentials, not merely emphasized on the differences and then indulged in that. A review of all these counter narratives underline the fact that the difference or the different voice of Indian Dalit women is not an issue of identitarian politics, some authentic direct experience, but from a long-lived history of lived struggles. Dalit women play a crucial role in transferring across generations the oral repertoire of personalized yet very collective accounts of their family's interaction with Baba Sahib or other leaders of the Dalit movement. The questions that emerge then, why that this difference, different voice of the Dalit women inaudible in the two major new social movements of the 1970s, namely the Dalit movement and the women's. The next section traces the issue through the latter while making the brief reference to the former. So she's after making this analysis of the pre-independent period, she's in which the Dalit women's voice were very, very, very loudly, you know, heard. Why that kind of thing did not happen in the latter movement is what she's trying to look into that. So this is the section where she talks about the masculinization of Dalithood and savarnization of womenhood. And this again, I hope you remember the point raised by Guru that the Dalit patriarchy is a reality and Dalit women have to really deal with that as well. So she is also acknowledging that. So she is taking more kind of a more detailed analysis of the Dalit movements and then try to see how they were sensitive to women's issues. So the new social movement of the 1970s and the early 1980s saw the emergence of several organizations and fronts such as the Sharmik Mukti Sangatana, Satishodha Communist Party, Sharmik Mukti Dal, Yuva Kranti Dal, none of whom limited the Dalit women to a token inclusion. Their revolutionary agenda in different ways accorded them a central place. This is, however, not the case with the two other movements of the period, the Dalit Panther and the Women's Movement. So this is again very, very important how Dalit Panther Party, which was more radical, okay, which was more militant to a large extent, sidelined the women's question, and then the Women's Movement, as constituted mainly by the left party-based women's fronts and the then emergence autonomous women's group. The Dalit Panthers made a significant contribution to the cultural revolt of the 1970s, but in both their writings and their programs, the Dalit women remained encapsulated firmly in the roles of their mother and the victimized sexual being. Okay, that was the characterization of Dalit Panthers. And a left party based women's organization also, you know, while they emphasized mostly on their subordinate position in terms of economic relations, how the factory systems or capitalist system produce a kind of a you know, exploitative system for the women, it very, very you know, strategically kind of avoided giving prime position to kind of caste identities. So all the women to be conceived as victims and therefore Dalit. So what that results is a classical exclusion. All Dalits are assumed to be males and all women Savarna. It may be argued that the categories of experience and personal politics were at core of the epistemology and politics of the Dalit Panthers movement and the women's movement. Such a position resulted into a universalization of what was in reality the middle class, upper caste women's experience and the Dalit males' experience. Okay, so that is very clear. That is the same argument that is put forward. It must be understood, underlined that most of the feminist groups broadly agreed that in the Indian context, a materialistic framework was imperative to the analysis of women's oppression. However, in keeping with their roots in the class framework, there were efforts to draw commonalities across class and all, to a lesser extent, caste or communities. This is apparent in the major campaigns launched by the women's movement during this period. So, the same point that we discussed. The absence of any analytical frame that in the tradition of Phule and Ambedkar would view caste hierarchies and patriarchies as intrinsically linked in apparent and in the anti-dowry, anti-rape and anti-violence struggles of the women's movement. Yeah, and so for example, she talks about how there were very concerted movements against dowry, okay, by the liberal women's organizations. But her argument is that the dowry, practice of dowry cannot be disconnected with the Brahminical patriarchy, because the practice of dowry is a heavily Brahminical practice, and in the process of cultural imitation, the host of castes kind of imitated this practice of dowry, brought in this practice into their life, and then so she argues that without kind of looking into this Brahminical influence of practices like dowry and other things, you can't really fight this social evil. The present practice of dowry cannot be outside the process of Brahmanization and their impact on the marriages of practices. That Brahminic ideals led to a preference for dowry. Marriage is well documented. Yeah, in fact, it's a colonial establishment of the legality of the Brahmin form of marriage that institutionalized and expanded dowry system. So this again, we have come across in various other literature that, the Brahminical ways of life, Brahminical cultural practices were kind of adopted and brought into other people's families, into their lives. And yeah, the relative absence of caste as a category in the feminist discourse on violence has also led to the encapsulation of the Muslim and Christian women within the question of talaq and divorce. So only concerning these two questions and not any other larger questions. Thus, in retrospect, it is clear that while the left party-based women's organizations collapsed caste into class, the autonomous women's groups collapsed caste into sisterhood, both leaving Brahmanism unchallenged. Okay, so this is the central point. The autonomous women's groups who are affiliated to the Dalit, they refuse to look at the caste as a major category, and they refuse to outrightly problematize and then critique Brahmanism as a central constitutive category. The movement was addressed. The movement has addressed issues concerning women of the Dalit, tribal and minority communities, and substantial gains have been achieved, but a feminist politics centering around the women on the most marginalized communities could not emerge. So that is her critique. Issues of sexuality and sexual politics, which are crucial for the feminist politics, remained largely within an individualistic and lifestyle frame. Issues of sexuality and are intrinsically linked to caste, and addressal of sexual politics without a challenge to Brahmanism results in lifestyle feminism. So this is an interesting thing, a term called as a lifestyle feminism, who flaunt feministic kind of symbols and then maybe rhetoric and other things without really challenging the larger structural things, and yet living a very very compromised personal and political life. So the second the section, she talks about a series of issues and series of violent incidents in India, which really showed the involvement of upper caste women against the interests of the women. And this is again well documented that at the time of caste conflict, at the time of religious conflict, at the time of communal and other ethnic conflicts, the religious solidarity or religious affiliation overtakes any affiliation of gender. Okay, so you will see upper caste women colluding with their men against or participating in violence against the lower caste women, or a particular religious group, women belong to a particular religious group, actively participating in unleashing violence against the women of the other religion. So these kind of question, these kind of processes have brought in a lot of important issues about the possibility of forging a larger alliance. So she gives the example of an anti-mandal agitation where a lot of upper caste women fought or argued against extending reservation to Dalit women. So all these are examples. All these are examples. She's talking about the study of Kalpana Kannabiran and who have pointed out how the deadlock between Kshatriya and Dalit men caused by the Dalit agricultural laborer women dressing well could be solved only by a decision taken by men of both the community. So also the example in Chunduru, the Dalit men were only getting some Dalit male activists did argue that in passing derogatory remarks about upper caste girls. So all these sections talk about the continuing patriarchal influence even among Dalit families, even among Dalit women. So her point is that the Dalit women, of course, while they are at the receiving end, have not really come out of the other structures of patriarchy, other structures of patriarchal influence. So this over celebration of differences and of identities and fragmented identities are kind of quite hollow in that argument. And then gives the example of Babri Masjid demolition where there were large section of women were involved. And even you know that in the Hindu right wing mobilization, women are a very, very important party to that, or in a host of other communal violence in Gujarat or in other places. Women actively participate in violence against the other religious group. Yeah, so such reconceptualization calls for a critique of Brahminical hierarchies from a gender perspective. Such critics have the potential of translating the discourse of sexual politics from individual narratives to collective contestations and hierarchies. In Brahminical social order, caste-based division of labor and sexual division of labor are intermeshed such that the elevation of caste status is preceded by the withdrawal of women of the caste from productive processes outside the private sphere. So she's talking about the kind of a larger Brahminical influence that significantly affected the prospects of women. So in the kind of a caste-based division of labor and sexual division of labor and intermeshed, such that the elevation of caste status is preceded by the withdrawal of women of that caste from productive processes outside the private sphere. So she is again inviting our attention to the practice of lower castes withdrawing women from productive processes outside the work and then making them to work only in the domestic sphere. And this was seen as a symbol of more respectable families or more respectable traditions and other things. Such a linkage derives from presumptions about the accessibility of sexuality of lower caste women because of their participation in social labor. Brahminism in turn locates this as the failure of lower caste men to control the sexuality of their women and underlines this as a justification of their impurity. So the women who go out for work, women who work in the field, women who have to travel a lot in the public spaces are seen as people with loose morality whose sexuality is available to others. So this again was imputed to the inability of their men to control their women properly. So there is a very close connection between the division of labor and the sexual division of labor and the Brahminical patriarchy. So that is the point that she talks about. Hence, caste determines the division of labor, sexual division of labor, and the division of sexual labor. Hence, there exist multiple patriarchies and many of their overlaps and differences are structured. Brahmanization has been two-way process of acculturation and assimilation, and through history there has been a Brahminical refusal to universalize a single patriarchal mode. Thus, the existence of multiple patriarchies is a result of both Brahminical conspiracy and the relation of the caste groups to the means of production. There are, therefore, according to Sangari, discrete specific to caste as well as overlapping patriarchal arrangements. Okay. Yeah. If feminists are to challenge these divisions, then mode of organizations and struggles should encompass all the social inequalities and patriarchies are related to, embedded and structured by. Does the different voice of Dalit women challenge these divisions? In the next section, we seek to outline the non-Brahminical rendering of women's liberation in Maharashtra. So this is the question that the patriarchy cuts across every caste. So does the Dalit women, their articulation, do they have the right to move beyond that? Now, the non-Brahminical rendering of women's liberation, she undertakes an example of that case in Maharashtra. These different organizations have put forth varying non-Brahminical ideological positions and yet have come together on the several issues, such as the issues of Bharatiya Sri Mukti Divas and the issues of reservation for OBC women in the parliament bodies. The emergence of an autonomous Dalit women's organization led to a major debate. A set rolling by the essay Dalit Women Talk Differently, Gopal Guru's essay that we discussed earlier. A series of discussions around the paper were organized by Pune by different feminist groups, a 2-day seminar by Alochana Center for Research and Documentation on Women in 1996. So let's see what is her take on Guru. Guru had argued that to understand Dalit women need to talk differently, it was necessary to delineate both internal and external factors that have bearing on this phenomenon. So internal factor, as we mentioned, it's the existence of Dalit patriarchy, and external voices, external factories, that they being co-opted by the general feminists. He locates their need to talk differently in a discourse of dissent against the middle class women's movement by the Dalit men and the moral economy of the peasant movement. It's a note of dissent. He argues against their exclusion from both the political and cultural arena. It is further underlined the social location determines the perception of reality, and therefore representation of Dalit women issues by non-Dalit women are less valid and less authentic. Okay, so this point is, again, we will come back. Though Guru's argument is well taken and we agree that Dalit women must name the difference, to privilege knowledge claims on the basis of direct experience on claims of authenticity may lead to narrow identity politics. So this is a very, very fascinating point of discussion. Okay, so Rege is the opinion that while diversity has to be acknowledged, okay, the argument that only a person who occupies a position understands the reality better will lead to more narrowing and then narrowed fields of view and then a kind of a narrow identity politics. Such a narrow frame may in fact limit the emancipatory potential of the Dalit women's organization and also their epistemological standpoint. The left party based women's organizations have viewed the emergence of autonomous women's organization as a setting up separate health. Moke argues that despite their earlier critique of the left party-based women's groups made by autonomous women's groups, the context of Hindutva and the new economic policy has brought both parties together, and the autonomous women's groups had once again come to share a common platform with the left. The subtext of Moke's argument is that autonomy is limiting and that the Dalit women's autonomous organization faced the threat of being autonomous from the masses. Because the moment you celebrate and then talk in an increasingly exclusivist language, you tend to get separated from the larger masses. To label any new autonomous assertion from the marginalized as identitarian and limited to experience, she argues, was to overlook the history of struggles by groups to name themselves and their politics. So this again, observations about the other experiences of other organizations in Maharashtra. The secular position is critiqued as Brahminical and individualistic, and the Ambedkarite conceptualization of the Dhamma in community life is underlined. The common civil courts is opposed as customary law. So these are all about how different arguments put forward by different organizations are presented. The Dalit Mahila Sangatana has critiqued the persistence of the Manuvadi Sanskriti among the Dalit male who otherwise trace their lineage to Phule Ambedkar ideology. The Sangatana proposed to put forth its manifesto, at the center of which would be the most Dalit of Dalit women. These non-Brahminical renderings of feminist politics have led to some self-reflexivity among the autonomous women's group, and their responses could be broadly categorized as a non-dialectical position of those who grant that historically it is now important that Dalit women take the leadership, but they also do not revision a non-Brahminical feminist politics for themselves. That is one of the important observations. Secondly, the left position that collapses caste into class and continues to question the distinct materiality of caste and who have registered a note of dissent on the declaration of December 25th as Bharatiya Streemukh Divas. And see, a self-reflexive position of this autonomous women's group who recognize the need to formulate and revision feminist politics for the non-Brahminical renderings are viewed as more emancipatory. So these are some of the important, important learning points that she puts forward. So this is an important essay in the sense it actually, problematized this kind of a difference that Gopal Guru articulates. While Gopal Guru is very assertive in arguing that women, Dalit women possess a distinct voice and they talk differently, Rege is more careful. Rege is more careful. Rege is raising more questions about how this can also lead to fragmentation without leading to a kind of a concerted political movement. So she is basically arguing that while these differences are important, these organizations should be more politically motivated and should have a more ambitious radical aims in dealing with or in frontally attacking structures of oppression like Brahminism or capitalism or the violence or the domination of the state. So that is her kind of a take on this whole debate. So this, as I mentioned earlier, it's a part of a larger debate, very very vibrant debate about people's position and whether this positionality renders their experience more noteworthy. Does it provide a kind of an epistemological privilege? Okay, epistemological privilege, and then what are the political implications of that epistemological privilege and this kind of debates? So we are concluding this paper here, and we are also concluding this week's discussion on Dalit sociology and mainstream sociology in India. Okay, see you for the next class. Thank you.